We had a little mechanical glitch again, but we'll be okay. Welcome to everyone this morning, everyone. Those of you who are members and visitors, we ask those of you who are visitors to please sign the guest register in the back, in the narthex, and we say welcome to you. It is good to be gathered together in God's house on Sunday morning. It's where we should be, and we are blessed to be here and to have this sanctuary to worship in. We thank the Lord for that. So welcome to you who are with us, and we pray God's blessing upon you. We've had a busy week. I had a busy week anyway. I finally realized on Friday that I've been in a hospital every day this week. Monday down to see Darren, Tuesday to see Carol, Thursday to see Wayne, and Friday to take Clara. So she was they were so thankful that Wayne has come through his surgery and is doing well. We also are thankful that Carol is responding well, and they are at home getting stronger right now. And we're thankful that Seth came through a procedure this week and he's doing well. And my Clara had surgery yesterday, and I don't know if she'll come home today or not, but we'll have her home this coming week. She's on the mend as well. So God has been good to us, and we have reason to thank him for that. Looking at our announcements, just to mention that next week was the Advent and Carol Sing at in the evening, Sunday evening at 6 o'clock. During the week, Thanksgiving service at 9:30 on Thursday morning, and where the offering will be going towards the Milford food pantries. We will be beginning a week from Wednesday. Our Advent series of Advent services, we're at the end of the church year today. Can you believe that? So next week we can wish one another Happy New Year when we come to church. Will be the first Sunday in Advent. I now have a sad announcement, and I don't have to make it, so I'll call on Tracy to do that.
Good morning. I received a call from Pastor Norby last Monday, and he declined the call that we had sent him, so I thought it was a pretty good feel, but God said no at this time. So I'm going to read a letter that he also followed up with to St. John Evangelical Lutheran Church, Schwer. I have been in prayerful consideration of the call which you have sent to serve as the pastor of the congregation. As my wife and I have prayed, we have determined that we will decline this call. We have had some questions about whether our time in Enderlin has come to an end. The time of prayer and consideration has led us to believe that we will remain here and continue to pray for God's direction. Our prayer is that God might grant to you as a congregation and as individuals a longing to hear, study, and pass on to others God's holy word. We are thankful for the people we met during our visit, and we will continue to pray that God might bring to you a faithful shepherd to care for Christ's sheep. May grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. 2 Peter verses 1 and 2. Amen. In Christ, Pastor Dennis Norby.
So we are challenged to continue to pray and to lift up the call committee that will be meeting on Tuesday night again to begin the process again, considering names. So pray for the call committee, and pray that God will lead us to the man that he would have us serve here as a congregation. Those being the announcements, let's bow before the Lord for a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you in Jesus' name, asking you to bless and guide and direct us as we consider these matters in prayer and these issues that are before us as a congregation. We thank you, Lord, for the great truth of the gospel that we have to share with one another. We pray that you would be with and bless this service, the sharing in music, in the time of praise, and the receiving of offerings, and the sharing of the word, and the preaching, and the singing of hymns. We pray that you'd bless each aspect of the service this morning. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Call on the praise team at this time.
We invite you to stand if you're able and join us as we gather together and begin our worship service.
Are you?
You may be seated.
Great is thy faithfulness. It's strange when you guys pick out songs and then I say our pastor's not accepting a call. I mean, that was the song we adopted, I believe, on one of our anniversaries. And he is faithful and he will bring us a shepherd. And that is a great song, I gotta say. I'm just excited about it. I love that song. The Old Testament reading is from Isaiah 40, verses 9 through 11. You who bring good news to Zion, go up on a high mountain. You who bring good news to Jerusalem, lift up your voice with a shout. Lift it up. Do not be afraid. Say to the towns of Judah, here is your God. See, the sovereign Lord comes with power, and he rules with a mighty arm. See, his reward is with him, and his recompense accompanies him. He tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and carries them close to his heart. He gently leads those that have young. The epistle lesson is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 12 through 23. Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, who care for you in the Lord and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard and love because of their work. Live in peace with each other. And we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive. Encourage the disheartened, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Rejoice always, pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good. Reject every kind of evil. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Here ends the reading of God's word.
I invite you to stand if you are able and to confess together our holy Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. Now I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Then the children, invite the children to come forward at this time. Well, I got my heart with me again. You remember what the first window said that we opened? Make sure I open the right window here now. I'm getting more windows all the time. Remember what it said? Bad words. Sometimes we have bad words in our heart, don't we? And then what did I say, talk about last week, what was in our heart? I couldn't get it to close before, now I can't get it to open. There we go. I can't hear you.
Selfish.
Why don't you all say it together?
Selfish.
Yeah. Well, none of us have that problem. Andrew's got a smile on his face. Oh, me first, myself second. If there's anything left over, I'll take it. That tends to be selfishness, doesn't it? Huh? Then this week we got a new word. What does that word say?
Hate.
Hate. I hate. Do you say, I hate you? You ever said that? Kind of comes out from inside, doesn't it? And that's not such a good thing, is it? And that one needs to get covered, doesn't it? The others were all covered with red, aren't they? The blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin. So we got to just say, and it's really good when we confess our sins, to say to Jesus, this is my sin. I hate. Help me with my hate. But you know what? It's an interesting thing. There's one thing that the Lord said we could hate, believe it or not. What do you think that is? Yes, Satan and evil. That's what it says in the Proverbs. Hate evil, love good. That's the better, isn't it? Do you love good? I love good. God loves good. And you know what? God loves you. And God loves me. So, take care of that little window there in your heart, would you? Let's pray and ask Jesus to take that one out. Dear Jesus, we confess to you that we have hate in our hearts. Please take that out of our hearts. Cleanse us from that sin. Amen. And then I'll cover it over with the red pen by next week. Thank you. Now we'll call the praise team again.
I will praise you, Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples. For great is your love reaching to the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Psalm 57, 9-11. I exalt you.
Let the glory be over.
The gospel text for this 25th Sunday after Trinity is found in the gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 11. And I'll be sharing verses 25 through 30. Will you please stand for the reading of God's word this morning? This is from Matthew chapter 11, 25 through 30. At that time, Jesus answered and said, I praise thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that thou didst hide these things from the wise and intelligent and didst reveal them to babes. Yes, Father, for thus it was well-pleasing in thy sight. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, nor does anyone know the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wills to reveal him. Now come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you shall find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my load is light. Father, these are thy words. Lead us and guide us into your truth, for your word is truth. Amen. You may be seated. Jesus is our everything. Everything. And he really desires that we would seek him in everything. There's a hymn, 357, if you're wondering where I'm reading from. Jesus is all the world to me, my life, my joy, my all. He is my strength from day to day. Without him, I would fall. When I am sad, to him I go. No other one can cheer me so. When I'm sad, he makes me glad. He's my friend. I find it so interesting. Over the years, and they're getting longer now, but going to retirement homes, when I ask for a favorite hymn, it's always What a Friend We Have in Jesus. It really resonates with us, doesn't it? And this morning in these verses, Jesus, our everything, has three very, very important things to say to us. First of all, that we come to know Jesus, our everything, because he has revealed himself as everything. Verses 25 and 26, sort of without a break, take us from a teaching situation and before all of these people, and standing before them, just sort of leads them right into prayer as he prays with the Father. At that time, Jesus answered and said, I praise thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that thou didst hide these things from the wise and intelligent and didst reveal them. Did you see that? He revealed them to babes. Yes, Father, for thus it was well-pleasing in thy sight. Jesus talks to the Father, and he calls him by name, Father. But Jesus also addresses God the Father as Lord. Isn't that interesting? That Jesus considers the Father his Lord. And if he considers the Father his Lord, to which also the Bible speaks of Jesus being Lord, then we ought to seek him to be Lord, both God and Father, in our lives. He is the Lord who reigns over heaven. and he is the Lord who reigns over the kingdom on here on earth. Now, it's very significant because the Father has not yet set up his kingdom here on earth, and yet he is Lord over the earth. And we don't have to wonder about that because Jesus said it. He's very clear about that. He acknowledges that the Father is the Lord of earth. Then Jesus, who knows and speaks to the actions of the Father, to him what Jesus calls these things. These, thou didst hide these things. And I wondered about that. What is he talking about? And it's important to understand what it is that's hidden and to what it is that God is revealing. The context reveals that Jesus is speaking of the substance of his teaching, these things that he is teaching, these things that he is preaching, these things that he is inculcating in the hearts and minds and lives of people. Lenski, in his commentary, describes these things as the gospel of the kingdom with its great principle of salvation by grace through faith in Christ. I tell you, Lenski's a good Lutheran. That's the issue, to know these things, because to know these things is to know Jesus and is to know the salvation of God given to us. At the same time, Jesus is saying back to the Father in this prayer that he was thankful for what the Father is hiding and for what the Father is revealing. What he is uncovering is really what the word really means. The divine hiding and revelation is without discrimination. In this sense, that the wise, more than the intelligent, are having it hidden as well as being revealed to them. That the prudent or the intelligent, it is being hidden or being revealed to them. That babes, well, who are the babes? Well, those nonverbal infants, right? Isn't that a babe? But there are those who are new in their faith, babes in their faith, that it's been hidden and it's being revealed. And then I love this, the unlearned and the simple. Boy, does that include me. I'm not really pretty very complex. Yeah, what you see is what you get, you know. And I'm just glad for that. I'm glad that God made me this way. Back in the years when I was in school and seminary, all these discussions about, how many angels can die and dance on the point of a needle and all this sort of nonsense, that never ever was interested me at all. I just take it at face value. God has kind of just made me that way, and he has revealed that to me, and I'm just so thankful for that. I don't need to have it hidden. I want to see it. Isn't that when you discover something and you see it, what happens? Ah, these aha moments. I'm so thankful for those. And God desires to reveal himself. He desires to show himself to us in Christ Jesus. That's why Jesus left heaven. That's why he came into the earth. That's why he is human being like we are. He was true God and true man. He experienced everything we did so that he knows, and we can see that he knows and he reveals himself to us. Jesus actually praises God the Father that he's doing it this way. And so do I. That's just what I experienced through the word this week. It is a blessing to me. Actually, this word in Greek implies that it was the Father's intention to do it this way, and it wasn't an accident. God has a plan. He's carried it out. God had a plan with a purpose, and I can tell you, he's still doing it today. I can personally tell you that, and I trust that you can too. There's no other way to understand the workings of God outside of his divine work to opening our minds and understanding. Otherwise, it's a puzzle. It's a hidden thing. And in those places where we come and we still don't understand, It's not God's fault. But it's, I like what Luther says, when I don't understand it, I tip my hat, I say good day, and I move on, and I believe that he's still the God who does it. That's why Jesus is our everything. Then Jesus seems to finish his prayer and turn to the people, and he says to them in verse 27, all these things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, nor does anyone know the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wills to reveal him. And the Son desires to do that, and he does. Barclays comments on this. See if this doesn't help you understand this back and forth between the Father and the Son, the Father, and revealed, and what's revealed, and so forth and so on. If you want to see what God is like, if you want to see the mind of God and the heart of God, then the nature of God, if you want to see God's whole attitude to men, Jesus says, look to me. Look to me, because he's our everything. Secondly, Jesus invites everyone, all. It's interesting when, I'm sure that most of you would say, what type of, grammatically, the word come, what kind of a word is that? Well, a command form, right? The imperative. No, it's not. It's a sort of rare exception in the Greek. I believe the word is deute. And what it really means is it's an exhortation. Come on, let's go, guys. We hear that on Saturday and hopefully Sunday, and I hope I can say it to the Vikings. I have to say it quite a bit lately. They haven't been going very well. Let's go. Come on. Come on. Jesus is everything for us, and he's there cheering us on. He's saying, come on, let's go. Go with me. The exhortation is plural, so it includes all. And it's directed, therefore, to all who do what? And he defines this. All of you who are laboring, come on, let's go. I want to encourage you, you who are tired of labor, who are fainting from weariness, to those who've been working so hard to work out their salvation, just let me take care of it. Let me go with me. This is the better way. This is the life-giving way. All who are heavy burdened. Well, I tell you, these verses really apply to us today, don't they, in our busy world? The demands of work and life. Those of you who have kids and you're running around to all you soccer moms and getting out to all these different activities and all the activities that go on, trying to keep up with everything. Those who are heavy burdened, those with feelings of guilt that come back to again and again accuse. For others, looking for something right in their lives. And we had this in the Sunday school class that I went to this morning, this rich man who came to Jesus and saying, is there just something I'm missing here? I've kept all the commandments, but there's just this kind of thing that's hanging behind me. I'm looking for the right things. And especially those of us who have this sort of guilt of not always matching and being where we ought to be in a community, many times the evangelical community of believers who are so legalistic, and there's always standards you got to always meet, and those are folks just bogus. There's only one who puts a standard, and his name is Jesus. And that standard is, I've fulfilled it all for you. Just trust me. Come on. Come on, let's go. Let's go forward. And then he says that There is, thirdly, command to a new pattern of life. And you could turn this into a legalism, and many have done that. But he says to us, will you, come on, let's go. I have my yoke to put on you. A yoke? I'm going to get yoked? I want to be independent. No, you come on with me. Yoke yourself with me. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Folks, if Jesus left heaven to come to the earth and to offer us a yoke and to be partnered with him, I don't know another place I want to be yoked at. How about you? My burden is light. My yoke, well, hey, you know, although we don't do so well in the United States now, but don't, when we get married, don't we get yoked to one another? We get yoked to a 30-year mortgage, don't we? We get yoked to a lot of things, don't we? And yet, what is the most important thing? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. My yoke is easy. My burden is light. We can partner with Jesus to walk through life together with him. And he is offering that to us. My yoke is easy. It's agreeable. It's good. It's a beneficial yoke. It's a useful yoke. And most of all, it's a well-fitting yoke. It's not like putting on a new pair of shoes when you're not sure if it's going to fit. It always fits us as people. But it's Jesus that gives it to us, not St. John Lutheran. Although we make commitments to St. John, we get yoked to St. John, don't we? But this is a yoke that we're talking about being belonging to the Savior. And wherever he goes, we go. You know, I used to say, some guys would say, oh yeah, you know, I take Jesus wherever I go. I take him with me. Nah. It's the other way around, folks. I go wherever he goes. Seeking first him and his kingdom, his yoke. The second command, to learn from me. Oh, I love that. You know that the root stem in Greek is mate, or mathete, is actually the Greek there. And mathete is the same word where we get Matthias, or translated into the English, disciple, which it comes from the root meaning learner. Learn from me. I have a school, Jesus said. He took 12 disciples. He gave them 3 years. They were learners, disciples, walked with Jesus, apprentices in the kingdom work. But we are all called to learn of Jesus. But there has a distinction in this when he says, come and learn. In other words, get into the school. Get enrolled with me, with my yoke upon you, and learn of me. Learn about this, how this. And he will lead us as we go through life together. And what is it that we're learning? Well, let me give you some specifics. Instead of getaway, I suppose I'm guilty like every pastor talking about generalities, but here's some specifics we can learn about Jesus. In place, learning gentleness in place of harshness. That's what he says, isn't it? Being gentle. Learning forgiveness in place of unresolved conflicts. Forgiveness. We need to learn that. That's what God wants to do. That's what happens when we get yoked to Jesus. Learning kindness in place of a mean spirit, a vengeance, like they say in Spanish, venganza. Vengeance. No. Kindness. Learning meekness in place of arrogance. Me first, as I mentioned to the kids, me first, myself second. If there's anything left over, I'll take it. That kind of mentality, changing to meekness. Learning lowliness in place of self-aggrandizement. Boy, did I, you know, we've heard a lot about that in these last election business. You know, boy, if you're with me, you're going to save the world. There's only one who saved the world, that was Jesus. Learning humility instead of pride being running rampant. Gentleness, forgiveness, kindness, meekness, lowliness, humility. Jesus really is our everything, and he's revealing himself, inviting us to come join him, be yoked with him, and to learn from him. The last stanza of 5:37, Jesus is all the world to me. I want no better friend. I trust him now. I'll trust him when life's fleeting days shall end. Beautiful life with such a friend. Beautiful life that has no end. Eternal life. Eternal joy. He's my friend. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have revealed yourself through your Son Jesus, and even Jesus, as he prayed to you, revealed a marvelous relationship, not only between Father and Son, but a desire between the Savior and the saved. And a world that is lost, desiring that more be a part of that kingdom. Thank you. For Jesus, you are all the world to me, to us. Amen.
God, and I will exalt you.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever.
We give thanks to you, O God. We give thanks.
Of love and still is our